with our next speaker, Ms. Eugene from Sandalotti, and he will talk us all about forest cover.
Yes. All right, I'm going to start, before I go to correlation analysis, I'm going to share quickly our experience with expansion microscopy. Since in our labs we do both palm storm, stat, so it was curious for us also to test it. And we also use the same techniques that Carlos made and very nicely explained before. So we also use this Moen protocol, we also tried glutaraldehyde and ACEs, they seem to work very nicely. And in general, this is what you get. You get your regular 80 millimeter cover slip and you get like a gel which grows there. And after some time, what you have is that you have this expanded gel. So the biggest problem for us was how to image this gel, because it's like really like jellyfish, super tender thing, how to bring it in the microscope without crashing it. It was a real big problem. So what we did, we actually developed some kind of 3D printing chambers to do that. So nice thing is that we did also the mold, so how we create initial gel. And this chamber, we use it for 24 by 50 big cover slip, so we can just cut it out of the gel. The other advantage of this chamber is that you can put the cover slip on the bottom and on the top, because what sometimes happens is when your sample expands in the water, when it snaps from the cover slip and can go any way around, on top or on the bottom, and then you have your gel and you don't know where your cells at the top or at the bottom, what you should, what can you image. So these chambers are super nice. And oh well, of course, and they are very cheap because you can order them. I have them here with me. So this is how it looks like. So you just put the cover slip over here, and this is what after expansion how it looks like. So you have this gel showing up. I wanted to film expansion, but it really looks like a water, so you just don't see it. It has the same refractive index. So you need to be really gentle, careful with this thing. And now, when we have this chamber, we can just cut out a portion of this gel, and we have it there. So this is actually like really reproducible and simple technique and really nice. You don't need to know anything. You just have like a couple of extra chemical steps. You know, for biologists, I think it's like a perfect super resolution technique. You don't need image analysis, nothing like that. So here you go, here you have it. These were our first results, also with glutaraldehyde we did it, and so yeah, it gives autofluorescence, but it actually can be very efficiently quenched by sodium borohydride. And so these are results before these things, and this is how confocal, regular confocal image looks like with not expanded sample, and this is how you see average microtubule size. So I must admit, so we're still at the process of optimizing things, and in all super resolution techniques, usually stat, storm, doesn't matter, for the staining you usually use 5 to 10 times more antibody, because well, you start to see things on the level of single molecule, so you your image is not convoluted anymore, and your microtubules, for example, stop being continuous. So whether it's the artifact of expansion, I'm not sure. So we still kind of want to validate it, because it's also very common for storm images. You see that microtubule, instead of continuous, becomes dotty depending on the staining diffusion. So this is result of expansion. So these are HeLa cells, and these are microtubules that we have there, and indeed you start to see this network much, much better. And this is glutaraldehyde thing, which actually disappears in some old images that I have. So this is how it's going to look if you would look it with a regular confocal. I just convolved it with a typical point spread function. So indeed you see these kind of non-continuous things, but microtubules are super nice, and yeah, it's not a like it's not really not an accident that super resolution techniques using them, because like the density of the staining is insane. So you have like a lot of molecules to do this thing. So it's very forgiving for the non-dense antibody labeling, because in the end the resolution depends not only kind of on what you can resolve, but also on the labeling density and on the how you label your structure. For example, we tried to do STAT on this, and actually does not give any effect. Well, because the thing that happens that microtubule is 20 nanometers, but then you use antibody and then it becomes like 60 nanometers and it already gives you 60 nanometers. So there's, you can do storm, but your microtubule will not become thinner unless you use different labeling technique like nanobodies or other things. In that sense, this is kind of, this is what you need. You don't need like to go more or deeper, let's say, with the conventional staining of antibodies. So indeed, Carlos also mentioned the great thing is that it's three-dimensional technique and it expands in all dimensions. And of course, you all, since it's microscopy meeting, of course, all of you know that actual XL resolution is 2 times less than XY, and this technique helps to overcome because also expansion happens in Z. Okay, but what I wanted to say is that indeed, so the main second problem that we have now is the drift. And well, it kind of makes sense because you have a gel, right, which is water, and then you have a glass, and then you have thin layer of water, and it's like typical situation when you have, like when you're skating, this is what happens, your skates actually create a layer of water, and that allows you to slide, so any ambient changes actually cause drift, plus evaporation also, what Carlos mentioned. So, and this is like very characteristic problem that arises in a lot of techniques, in other techniques too, for example, in storm techniques. You also, if you acquire for, let's say, 15 minutes your data set, then you need to correct for the drift because your stage moves even on the nanometer scale. So, I'm using this to give a short intro and to cross-correlation methods and show their application in different microscopy techniques for movie analysis and etc. So these cross-correlation methods, as I mentioned, there are a lot of plugins for imaging and standalone software that uses this cross-correlation method to correct for drift. But if you go deep down to original paper, there it was published in around 1995-93, and it's called Fast Template Matching or Fast Normalized Cross-Correlation. So I digged out this paper, and in that paper there was a quote that actually this method was used for movies like Forrest Gump, Cliffhanger, and Speed. I don't know how many of you remember these movies, but anyway, I'm a big fan actually of Forrest Gump movies, so I digged out on, I did a Googling and on YouTube, I found the things. So where did they use this drift and cross-correlation? So, turns out there is a special where all these special effects creator people explain how they did all these special effects. And I don't know, do you remember these movies where Tom Hanks, who plays Forrest Gump, is kind of embedded into different kind of historical footage. And in this case, he meets John Lennon, right? So there is also some other scenes when he does different things. So they explain actually how they do this. On the example of the movie that is not incorporated in the final Forrest Gump, so you haven't seen this. And this is the movie when they wanted to have Forrest Gump playing tennis with George Bush, which at that time was ambassador in China. So if you look at this movie, so how you would put, so you need to create some kind of footage of Tom Hanks playing, right? And then probably with a blue screen at the back. But the second thing that you actually, if you look closely to this movie, you will see that the camera constantly moving. It's zooming in and zooming out, right? So whenever, so you don't know the coordinates of the camera, how it was changed. So you somehow, from this footage, you need to figure out what were these coordinates. So to put Tom Hanks, like, trying to hit balls, it was, like, really easy, right, of these things. But then what they needed to know is they needed to find some kind of immobile feature in the original footage and then try to track all the movement of the things of the camera and then in the same way shake the camera with this footage, right? So as it was mentioned, this is now a standard feature of a lot of After Effects and everything, and I picked this explanation from actually tutorial to After Effects, where the guy puts himself on the Beatles video, and you see that they use this thing to track how the camera is shaking. This is the trajectory of shaking. And then he takes an immobile video of himself, you see, and makes it shake with the same amplitude so that his image shakes in synchrony with the background of the things, right? So how do you track this immobile feature that you use for the thing? Yeah, so by the way, this is like the final result. And what you can see that actually the background is completely static, right? So actually nothing going on, and this is why you can see also that this side of the scene, so there are still some balls hanging here, and you see that it's actually synchronized and immobile. Later you realign everything, and now you have a perfect scene of Tom Hanks playing with George Bush, so it's like works like a charm. So the question is, what's the basic, so now you kind of know the motivation and what's the basic thing behind the cross correlation, and the idea is to kind of invent a function which will somehow tell you how similar one signal is to another. So here I have two signals, the blue one and the green one, and I want to have a number how far they're from each other. And actually the most naive kind of function is just the distance between each nodes at each point. So these green lines, I just count the length of all the green lines. And then the thing is, if I move the signals with respect to each other on some distance, for example, now the green signal, I move it by the x and it becomes the red signal. Now, if I calculate the sum of all the red lines, definitely you can see that it's less, right? So that's good because computer doesn't know what is similar, what is not similar. Computer understands only numbers, and we give him this explanation, and now he's super happy. Okay, I'm going to do like everything. So now you can shift one signal with respect to another as much as you can to all the different positions, and for each shift you can calculate this distance, and it will tell you how good the overlay between two structures is. So this is the general idea behind the cross correlation. There are a lot of different things. So this is actually the distance, this is the function that you want to have. This is one signal, this is another signal shifted by some value. And this is like a little bit of math to show that in the end this is like convolution, and these two terms, they're actually responsible only for the shape of the signals, but this is the main thing. So that's how you apply the cross correlation. So what you have is you have one image, you have another image, and then for each shift in x and y you calculate how far the image is between each other, and then now having the map, you can build the map, right? So for each displacement in x, for each displacement in y, what is the similarity between these things, right? And then if you find in the maxima, this maxima will correspond to perfect overlay. Going back to the expansion microscopy thing, this is how it's going to look like. So on the left you see non-corrected original stack, and here what you see is the map of cross correlation between each consecutive frame. And you definitely see that there is a peak here, so it shifted in the opposite direction of the movement, right? So for each frame you can calculate shift and apply it for the next Z stack, and in that sense you definitely correct for, you see that the thing almost not moving, and you can actually very nicely see it on maximum intensity projection, so you see that this one is really smeared out while this one is not. Of course this technique is used in a lot of things, but of course it's also used in the microscopy thing. So here one of the usages of this technique is to stabilize your camera when you try to shoot, because all these cameras GoPro, they're very light, but you can also apply it to some other techniques. So in this case you have a migration of the cell, and if you're only interested in the front and you want to see how the shape of the front is changing, what you actually can do, you can stop the migration, and in this movie you will only analyze like moving front without the need to shift anything, so it's kind of stabilizes everything on its own. So it's quite relatively old technique but very powerful. So there is also this very classical paper from by Juliet Theriault, when they actually analyze the movement of keratinocytes, and they are able to kind of stop to go into the system of coordinates which is traveling together with this keratinocyte, and you can see here actually this guy, it looks like it stands in one place but it actually moving, but the camera moving together with him. So since it's microscopy meeting, so it's not the only thing that you can do. Since it's microscopy meeting, this technique, the correlation technique, can also be used as a template matching. There was recent paper from Tom Schmidt's lab where they actually wanted to image bacteria floating in three dimensions using the phase contrast microscope. And as you can see, Well, these bacteria are super small. They sit almost sub-diffraction level. And as you can see, it's really hard to determine where each bacteria is in Z. And the reason for that is that the point spread function in phase contrast is like ridiculous. It really depends on all the microscopes and everything, and it doesn't have any regular shape. Because what you usually do in storm, you know how it changes with Z, so you can somehow recalculate the Z coordinate. In this case, nothing like this. So, but what they did, they pick one subdiffraction object, and they just did a Z-scan with all these multiple circles and everything, and then they used the cross-correlation just to find a specific Z-position. So they just calculate correlation of the frame from the movie with the library and find the best one. In that sense, they know the Z-position. And this is exactly what happens here, as you can see. So it not only gives you XY coordinate, but also by knowing from which library it's picked up, they know the Z coordinate with the best cross-correlation things. And from that, of course, they can very nicely calculate three-dimensional trajectory of the particle, of the bacteria, and calculate the speed and everything. The other interesting application where autocorrelation is used a lot is to actually calculate cross-correlation of the image with itself. So it's also used a lot to characterize these actin rings for supers, which were discovered using storm technique some time ago. Because one way to characterize, so you see it's a very patterned structure, and what you can do is actually you can measure the distance between each stripe and another stripe, but it's like a lot of work, right? So you don't want to know. You don't want to image like 100 distances and everything. The best thing that you would like to do is to say, okay, what's the average distance between all of these lines? So what you can do is you can calculate cross-correlation of the image with itself, with all possible shifts. And the cool thing about it is that it will just give you exactly the average thing. So this is how the cross-correlation map will look like. And of course, here in the center you have zero because the correlation is maximum of the image with itself, but then as it shifts, you see that you actually, you don't have stripes in the y direction, but you have stripes in x direction, and now you can just draw a line, and here you go, you have like very nicely characterized in one click values. You can do this not only for static pictures, but you can also do it for different kind of, all kind of structures which have some kind of regularity. This is very famous now, well, so this is, it is famous system of two proteins which E. coli uses for the division, but the thing is if you remove all the components, it behaves like famous Belousov-Zhabotinsky reaction, which forms these all these kind of patterns. And again, you can measure the distance between, to characterize the parameters of the system, you can measure the distance between these expanding stripes, or you can calculate, again, cross-correlation between two consecutive frames. And you see that actually it's not changing, and again, very easily you can derive the things out of it. So the other interesting application of cross-correlation is that it's not only a measure of similarity, but you can think, okay, it's actually a measure of non-similarity between these things. So actually you can apply it to see how quickly things become non-similar, right? And this is something that we recently did in our preprint paper where we studied the behavior of microtubules inside cells. And actually what we saw that all these microtubules shake a lot inside the cell. If you acquire them, and then if you treat, if you depolymerize the actin, or if you tinker with actin in a different way, they start to shake more. And one of the reviewers' comments was to how can we quantify somehow this movement. And one of the approach was like, try to track individual filaments and see the amplitude and speed of shakiness and all these things. But already by eye you can see that this guy seems to shake here more vigorously, at least faster than the guys in the control situation. So we decided let's make a chymos and see whether we see something from the chymos. And it looked like, yes, we can see that here the amplitude of shakiness is more and here it's less, but how to put a number on the thing, it's really hard, right? Unbiased thing. So in this case, the single particle tracking was almost impossible, and we thought to try and use the correlation methods. And I'm going to go a little bit from the other side of it. So what we can do is, well, is the classic Fourier FCS, Fourier correlation spectroscopy technique. And what you do in this case, you actually calculate cross correlation with different time shifts. So you have, you image a volume over a long time, and then you want to know how your intensity of one pixel of your volume changes over time. But you want to know not with respect to, let's say, from the beginning till the end, but you want to know on average in 1 second, no matter where you start, how the intensity changes. That's why it's called not really time, but delay. Then you do the same with 2 seconds, 3 seconds, so etc., etc. So that's what you do. So you calculate for all the pairs of the pixel, you calculate with the time shift of 1, and then you calculate the average. Then you do the same for the longer shift and the longer shift, and then you have this function which actually now depends on the average, depends only on the on time shift. And the interesting property about this function is that, of course, it decays, because at some point you have some kind of intensity, and then this particle leaves volume, and then the change in the intensity will become less. And this is the artificial data that they generated. It's just a chymos, and here I calculate for each pixel this correlation, and here I build it, and here you see some kind of diffusion. And then the thing is, if diffusion becomes smaller of these particles, you see the correlation decays slope, right? Because the particle leaves the volume, all particles leave the volume later. And that's actually, you can see that it does not depend on any position. It's the average over all the image. Here is even slower diffusing particles. And this is a really great technique which is used in a lot of biophysical applications to measure diffusion coefficient and everything. But again, so we kind of, we have much more information here than we have in just single time trace. So for example, the interesting thing, if we have diffusion with confinement, actually it will look like something in between these guys, but actually it has exactly the same thing. So it's really hard to analyze this data set. You need to build some kind of hard models, different models with different equations, and try to fit one or another. But the thing is that is present in this case is the spatial information, which is actually absent in the case of FCS, where the acquisition happens only in one spot. So we can incorporate that and calculate the cross correlation a little bit differently. So if we have our chymo where we have space and time, what we can calculate is the regular space correlation in terms of, like, when we change only delta x. Again, we do the average on everything, but then also we can calculate cross correlation in time and space. And again, average for different values. And then what happens is, yeah, you can calculate it differently, but long story short, what happens is that you're calculating, this is spatial correlations for different delay times of the time. So this is, you see in the beginning, it drops like this, but if you have longer time, actually it drops longer because you're calculating cross correlation between two even separated in time. So you have already less correlation, but it's even less than you see. Maybe it's a little bit more clear here that you see that this is, you can think about it as a diffusion coefficient, as a Bleachian experiment or photoactivating experiment. So in the beginning, everything stays in one place, and then everything kind of diffuses away. So this is what the cross correlation map shows in this case. So for the if you start to decrease the diffusion, of course you see that your cross correlation persists more, right? So all these are artificial data, but it works really well. And in this case, I'm not tracking individual particles. It's actually impossible to do the same, but nevertheless I'm acquiring the information about the movement of the average quantification of all these things. So interestingly, what you can do if you draw a line here, right, you will have these exponential functions, so this is only half of the thing, and you can feed them very nicely with Gaussian things, and there is paper where they actually say that it would be proportional to the mean square displacements. This is very similar to the analysis that you do from the tracking. And this is exactly the test of the thing. So this is, it's called image mean square displacement, and from the regular movie without the tracking, with the super crowded environment, you actually can calculate diffusion coefficients quite robustly. So this is exactly what we did for our analysis, and you can see, yeah, that these guys, these three guys, these two and this one don't change much, and this moves a lot. And actually what we were able to see is that not only like initial part of the slope, not only the speed of oscillations is increased, but also the saturation, so the confinement size is increased. So in this case, of course, we analyzed randomly moving particles, but in a lot of applications, what you need to analyze is again directionally moving particles. In case of actin transport, dynes, for example, kinesins, molecular motors, and other active transport. So the same technology, which is actually called STICS, I forgot to mention, which is spatial temporal image correlation spectroscopy, can be applied to the same kind of data. So this is some chymo I took from this paper, and usually the way this chymo is analyzed is that you need to find the specific lines and you need to draw a lot of these lines and measure the velocity of the things, which is a bonafide technique, especially if you want to know the distribution. But if you're just in general interested whether you have what's the average speed of the population and what's the distribution of the thing, you can use the same correlation method. So you can split actually this chymo into the retrograde and anterograde moving vesicles and cystatic components. It would look something like this. And then for each of the methods, you can calculate the same cross-correlation. In this case, cross-correlation will not spread, right, because it's not diffusion, but it will move, because each particle here will have a good correlation with this shift in time and space. So this is exactly what you see here. So in this case, you don't need to measure all these things, you can just measure this slope and the width, and then you will know the average distribution of the particles. The same thing for here, and actually in this case you also see that there are different slopes. And this is why here you have two lines. So probably there are two populations of vesicles moving with two different speeds. So the correlation map immediately gives you this thing. So the same way as you do it 1D, you can do the same thing that we did in 2D. So when you, in the beginning for the drift correction, you calculate the correlation map between first and second frame, third, second and third frame, and etc., etc. So you can do the same, but now with different delays. So when you have delay or just one frame, two, three, and etc., etc. And in this case, you will have not like this chymo, but you will have map. So here you again, you will have this peak of autocorrelation, and then if it's diffusion, it will gradually like spread out, because of course, like the, if you have the gap of 10 frames, the diffusing particles will change their position and correlation will become less. So you can use it again to calculate the square displacement. And it's actually quite handy for different techniques. So I work a lot also with biological images and movies, and sometimes it's nice to have some kind of number, because not everybody will go to supplementary information and watch the movie, right? But also, again, looking at this thing, it's hard to calculate diffusion coefficient, but also you see that it seems that there is a little bit of flow. So how to put a number on that? And it's really hard, or in some cases, so this is like some protein which shows this kind of dynamics, and in some cases it's really hard to get a really big signal so you're able to track, or it's too crowded. Again, you can try to do this two-dimensional spatial correlation on this thing, and this is how this map will change over time. So what you can see here is actually by the position of the peak, you can see that since the peak moving, you have some kind of flow, and this the move by the position of the peak movement, you can characterize the speed of the flow. And by the speed with which the peak becomes wider, you can actually characterize the diffusion coefficient of the particles. So here you go, instead of like a very hardly definable thing, just from this movie you can get very nice numbers that you can in the end compress into bar plots, which are the best plots for the biological papers, you know, probably, right? Everybody likes two bar plot. One is much higher, and there are three asterisks, right? So last part, where the correlation methods are very widely used, is in fluid mechanics and other techniques like when you need to see how the gas flows in the aerodynamics. And what they do, they use particle image velocimetry. And in this case, they film in something, they add some tracer particles, and they film the flow. And then from the movies of the flow, they can calculate so-called optical flow. So they can calculate a speed of the flow at each of the positions. And in this case, it also relies on the correlation technique. And as you can see here, there is it's a coffee cup with some liquid rotating inside. So to calculate the field of velocities on this thing, what you usually do is you have these two frames, you split it into smaller areas, and now you calculate the cross-correlation maximum between a cross-correlation of small area here and small area here, the same way as you as we calculated it for the drift. So then the distance between these maxima gonna give you a displacement vector, which is the speed vector, right? So it's gonna give you both the direction and the amplitude of the thing. And this is how it's gonna look. As you can see, it's actually very realistic and works really nice on this kind of simplified image, but it's very widely used for image analysis of the for the microscopy movies. So this is another example where the movement of the cells, okay, let's play it, of the epithelial cells was analyzed in the flow thing. So what you see at the bottom is the distribution of the velocity vector field in things. There are a lot of multiple packages available that you can use and apply for your thing. So also there a lot of other structures are used to track, like which are hard to track with object recognizable methods, like the focal adhesions and you name it. So okay, I want to finish on this thing. So we went from the special effects up to the fluid and oil dynamics, and I hope it was a bit entertaining. I want to thank all the people that helped me and work on these things, and I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Eugene, for this very interesting talk. Do you have any questions?
Yeah, I would like to know if you're going to apply this kind of method to correct not only just for movement, but also like if your tissue is like drifting in different directions and not just moving in one, you know, and try to correct it.
Yeah, it is possible. Actually, in that example, so you're thinking about if something also rotates and expands,
yeah.
Right? Yeah, it is possible. In that movie that I showed you with this keratinocyte,
yeah.
It actually not only moves straightforward, it also rotates and things. So yeah, it's you just need to switch to the polar coordinates, and then it's kind of.
But also like not only rotation, but also like let's say
yes.
And you can put it back to a reference frame.
Yeah, exactly. It is possible.
Sorry, can you also do that in 3D?
Yeah. Yes, it is possible.
More questions? It's a very clear talk, I think. Well, let's go to the
hope so.
Well, we'd like to invite you to have some drinks with us and to share some ideas about your questions. And otherwise, I'll see you on our next meeting, which will be in
Switch it off?
Yeah.